Hello everyone and a very warm welcome from the UK to today's online service. I'm Claire and this is my husband Tim, and we're part of the leadership team of Senior Pastors Wes and Adriana Richards at King's Church International in Windsor. It's our privilege to introduce today's service.
Yes, and as always we give a very special welcome to everyone from King's Church International in Windsor, in London, and of course in Robertson, South Africa, and to everyone joining us from around the UK and all other nations.
Last weekend we had many celebrations. It was Pentecost Sunday and Her Majesty the Queen's Platinum Jubilee celebrations. Pastor Adriana preached about the importance of togetherness, and it was indeed a time of great togetherness as we gave special tributes to honour the Queen's many years of faithful service and unwavering Christian faith. In this programme, we will be looking back at some of the highlights of this special weekend.
Yes, and today is also something of a milestone as we conclude our series Discovering the Real Jesus, based on our studies from the Gospel of John, which began way back in January. In our final session today, Pastor Wes will be sharing from the last chapter of John, when Jesus commissioned his disciples to share his love with people and to carefully look after them. And of course, this was something that was done so systematically and passionately by John Wesley and his team of leaders and disciples.
Yes, it's quite a story which Tony Bramley will be telling us more about in a very informative feature. But first, as always, let's pray.
Yes, please bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love and for your amazing mercy towards each and every one of us. Lord, we just pray today that you would send your Holy Spirit into our hearts and to our homes, and that we would have a fresh touch from you today, Lord, that you would open our hearts to receive this amazing word. And we pray all this in your precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn. Then I met you. I was breathing but not alive. And all my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my name.
Darkness into
rescue. My sin was heavy, the chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you are my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. When you call my name, I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness, into your glorious day. Took a breath, you breathe your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found. Your foe, still your love poured for me. You've been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain. John 14, verses 15 to 17. If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you.
John 14, verse 26 to 27. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you.
Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid.
Romans 8, verse 26 to 28. The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for. The Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans.
And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose.
Galatians 5, 22 to 25. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit.
Matthew 9 verses 35 to 37. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in the synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd.
Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field."
Hi, we're John and Hayley. This past week in the UK, we've been celebrating the Queen's 70th Platinum Jubilee. And here in Windsor, it's been absolutely buzzing, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has. And we as King's Church International celebrated the Jubilee in a number of ways on Sunday. We had special performances, our pastor gave a tribute, we had messages from our church, our King's House School, the children came and sung the national anthem for the Queen. And we're going to look at some more of these highlights now.
I was glad, very glad, when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord together." This verse from Psalm 122 is traditionally played at the coronation of a British monarch. This is the Queen's Platinum Jubilee, 70 years on the throne. Great numbers of people have watched from around the world. Her Majesty is greatly loved and greatly respected. The very bedrock of her character is her Christian faith. But I believe that we as a church should be very thankful to God for Her Majesty. Let's give her a big hand. And we pray that the Lord will look after her for many years. and that she would know in a new way the presence of God.
Your Majesty, congratulations on your Platinum Jubilee. We're so grateful for this opportunity to be able to honour you and thank you for your leadership and for your example to us throughout these 70 years.
When I think about everything you've done, I think about the faithfulness, fortitude and family you have modelled to this nation.
Thank you for your faithful service of our nation and for your clear faith in our Saviour.
I've been inspired by your serving heart and attitude, and I feel so privileged to have experienced this in my lifetime during your reign.
I'm inspired and admire the way you're not afraid to share your Christian faith with the world and especially the nation.
I've been inspired by your resilience and your prayers for our country.
Congratulations, Your Majesty, on your Platinum Jubilee.
Her Majesty the Queen wants this time be a time when we all come together in unity. This is the day, in the midst of this celebration of this Platinum Jubilee for our Queen. She is the great example how she shared the gospel, the most famous woman in the world. She never is afraid to speak about Jesus.
Joshua Richards, he's going to perform Zadok the priest for us.
Father, we thank you for our Queen.
We thank you so much that she has always stood firm, Lord Jesus, on you. We thank you so much that she has always served you wholeheartedly.
We thank you for her faithfulness, Lord, her faithfulness to you, her faithfulness to this country, to its people, Lord.
Lord, we thank you that she truly has been a light in this world and has obediently followed you and always lifted your name up.
And Lord, that we pray that she will leave a legacy for the monarchs to come, Lord, as the defender of faith.
Thank you, Lord, that you've blessed us, Lord, with a Christian queen, Lord, someone that loves you, Lord, that has sought to serve you, Lord, her whole life. Thank you for her example.
Lord, and on Pentecost Sunday, Lord, we thank you that we've been blessed with a head of state who has modeled the fruit of the Spirit, Lord, in particular, patience, kindness, and faithfulness.
Thy choicest gifts in store, on her be pleased to pour, long may she reign. May she defend our laws and ever give us cause to sing with heart and voice, God save the Queen. Amen.
God save our gracious Queen. Long live our noble Queen. God save the Queen. Send her.
They had rocks thrown at them, they were beaten, and their lives were frequently in danger. But it was their continued passionate communication of the love of God that caused masses of ordinary working people to receive the good news of Jesus, from the 18th century evangelists like John Wesley and George Whitefield. Wesley's brother Charles, in one of his 6,000 hymns, well captured the emotional and spiritual warmth that lay at the heart of what became a movement of social, spiritual, and political transformation that spread across nations and indeed generations. In his famous hymn, Jesus, the name high over all, he wrote, "Oh, that the world might taste and see the riches of his grace, the arms of love that welcome me, would all the world embrace. When so many people with all kinds of problems felt God's love and became Christians, Wesley recognised that each and every one of them needed to continually receive individual attention and training as disciples of Jesus. George Whitefield, said to be the more powerful preacher than Wesley, admitted himself that although he gained many new converts at his meetings, he couldn't nurture the souls of so many of his own followers who simply slipped away from the faith. He commended the wisdom of John Wesley, a genius of organisation who devised a meticulous system and method of individualised care. John Wesley ensured that every person was under someone else's direct and immediate supervision, so that, as John put it himself, not even the slightest affliction would go unnoticed. John called them classes or societies, and each class had an appointed leader. And each week, these classes would meet at first in homes and later in purpose-built chapels. And while it all sounds like a cell group system, it could be more accurately compared to the very focused G12 vision of ministry and discipleship pioneered in recent decades by Pastor Cesar Castellanos of Colombia. Like a G12 cell, Wesley's groups were not a social gathering as such, but every week they were a real system of purposeful discipleship and accountability. Records were kept of attendance, spiritual growth, and condition of each individual. And in fact, near the end of his life, Wesley once claimed that he knew all of the 30,000 people in his societies by name and what the condition of their spiritual life was. Something that very much rattled the cages of some of the religious leaders of the time was that he appointed many uneducated working class people to lead his classes and to preach at large gatherings or conferences, as they eventually became known. Men who had been in the coal mines all their life were suddenly learning to speak with authority in public. Women were being given responsibilities and roles previously unheard of, and this was very countercultural and paved the way for women in leadership. Many social historians with no interest in Wesley's religious activities have written about the socially transformative impact of his methods. One historian wrote that Methodism provided a field for social leadership and social change. And today, the impact of Wesley's Methodists on British society and in nations as diverse as the United States and South Africa is widely recognised. Nelson Mandela, for example, went to a Methodist school. But yet it all began with Wesley himself experiencing the love of God and sharing that gospel of love far and wide. And when people had their own hearts strangely warmed by the love of Jesus, they lovingly and systematically looked after everyone who wanted to be a disciple of Jesus. And that is something that is urgently needed locally and globally in the modern day church. And that is something that we as a church are committed to. And in a very real sense, we are also the Methodists of today.
Well, hello everyone, and a special greeting once more to all of you in the King's Church International family in Robertson, South Africa. Now today I have a very special theme for all of you. My theme is, this is your time for restoration. Today I want to tell you that if you are down, then this is your time to get up. For whatever problems you may face or may have faced, you can see great recovery in your emotional, mental, spiritual, and physical health. Whatever setbacks you may have experienced in your life or your family or your business, this is a moment for comeback and for you to return to fulfilling the destiny that God has for you. Almost exactly 20 years ago, I personally needed restoration in my own life and ministry. For at that time, although I had been a pastor then for almost 3 decades, I hadn't preached for many months. This was because my life had gone in an unexpected and in an unwanted direction. And I needed to focus all my time and all my energy on giving my full support to my terminally ill first wife. And then after she died, I spent nearly 3 months on a break with my 3 similarly heartbroken children. We went to America and stayed with some wonderful, faithful friends of ours, Pastor Mike and Linda Peters from St. Louis in the Midwest. And it was there one day that he quietly took me aside and he told me that I would be the guest preacher at his church on the forthcoming Sunday. Before I could express my concerns, he said to me, sounding like a Midwestern cowboy, "This, my friend, is where you get back in the saddle." And that's how, with some nervousness, I got back to preaching again. Today, as we conclude our series on discovering the real Jesus, we come to the final chapter of John's Gospel, where we see that the disciples of Jesus also needed great restoration. After the arrest and crucifixion of Jesus, the disciples had run away and they had lost their way. They were shaken up, they were confused, because what they had expected to happen with Jesus had not happened, and what they didn't expect to happen to him had happened. And they had been plunged into great darkness, confusion, and sadness as they saw their beloved Messiah, teacher, and friend hanging, bloodied and beaten on a Roman cross. And so they closed in on themselves, meeting behind locked doors. They went into hiding from the world, and they were certainly in no condition at that point to change the world. Despite twice having met Jesus in post-resurrection appearances, they had gone back to their familiar world of fishing, and they'd caught absolutely nothing. We pick up the story now in John chapter 21, 1 to 5. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon, Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee and two other disciples were together. "I'm going out to fish," Simon Peter told them, and they said, "We'll go with you." And so they went out and they got in the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you caught any fish?" "No," they answered. Despite their empty nets, however, this was the moment that their restoration began. And I want to highlight some areas where they were restored, which are areas where we too may well need restoration. First of all, I want to speak of the need to be restored in our vision for the multitudes. Let's read from verses 6 to 11. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you will find some fish." And when they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he'd taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. How detailed the Bible is. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Now, if this story sounds familiar to you, that's because it is. This is the second time recorded where there was a big miracle catch of fish. Now, the first one happened at the start of the ministry of Jesus and is recorded in Luke chapter 5. And verses 4 to 5 tell us there how at Jesus' direction they let down their nets to catch fish, even though they'd worked hard all night and they had caught nothing. Verses 6 to 11 says, "When they'd done so, they caught such a large number of fish that their nets began to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and they filled their boats so full that they both began to sink. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, 'Go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man.'" For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish that they'd taken, and so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will fish for people." So they pulled their boats up on the shore, left everything, and followed him. Now this was the moment that the disciples understood that God could do more in and through their lives than they had previously imagined. Just as they had caught many fish, now Jesus was showing them that they would be used to bring many people, many, many people into the kingdom of God. Jesus later told them to feed the multitudes with the bread from heaven, as we've seen in our studies, and to take his message throughout the world. Now, for 3 years, the disciples had seen, while Jesus was interested very much in individuals, but they had seen great crowds of people touched by the ministry of Jesus, just as I, and in actual fact, a lot of people have gone to places such as South Korea or Colombia or the Philippines to see great numbers of people come to the Lord. It's amazing to see these huge churches. But then for the disciples, after having all this big vision of abundance and big crowds and many people turning to Christ, then the crucifixion happened. They felt all alone, and their vision for the multitudes to come to Christ was lost. But here in this post-resurrection appearance on the shores of Galilee, Jesus showed them once more that they could have a very big catch when they trusted and obeyed him. We too need to keep our vision of winning great numbers of people to Christ. It's so easy for us to lose the big picture, and that's often because of the everyday worries and concerns of life that can just overwhelm us. Jesus wants us to keep on inviting many to the banquet of the kingdom of God. But often, as in the parable in Luke 14, we find that we are too busy with other things like business or family matters. Yet our master tells us to go out everywhere, the alleys, the streets, every part of the towns and cities, to get people so that the house of God may be full. Now, right through the Bible, right from the Old Testament, Genesis, in fact, we see that God's heart was for multiplication, was for increase, was for fruitfulness. And he wants us to be a people of faith with a limitless vision, not a limited vision, of many, many people coming into the family of God. Genesis 15:5, we remember how God told Abraham to look up the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said, so will your offspring be. In our story here, the disciples needed to quickly have their vision renewed because their moment of ministering to the masses was much nearer than they actually imagined. For within a few weeks, they would stand up as a team before a vast international crowd of people, and 3,000 people, would be added to the church one day. So there needed to be a rapid transition from their own personal pain and self-focus. And today is a moment also for us to have a new vision and a new faith for the multitudes. Maybe like the disciples, you face tough times, discouragements, opposition, and it seems like your work isn't achieving much. You feel like you perhaps lost the vision God once gave you. You've fished all night and caught nothing. But you can and you will see great results, and we will as churches, when we trust and we obey the Lord. For he can take you and us and make you and use you to work many miracles through you. And this is a time, I believe, to expect new blessings, great blessings, not a few blessings, but many blessings in your family, for people to be won to Christ, the people to be interested, the people say, yeah, I want the Lord, for families to be united in living for God. This is a time to have many people in the church coming to Christ. This is a time to see many great churches established all over our cities and our towns. It's a time to see transformation, not just in family life, but in the nations throughout the world. This is a time to see abundant blessings. As we often quote William Carey, that great missionary pioneer who said, "Expect great things from God and attempt great things for God." So this morning, whatever's gone on today, evening, wherever you're watching this program, whatever time, you need to know that God has a bigger vision for your life and can use you in a far greater way than you ever imagined. So that's the first thing, having a renewed vision, a restored vision. The second thing is to be restored in our experience of the love of Jesus. Now look what happened here to the disciples, and especially to Peter, who had denied the Lord and felt such a failure. Maybe you can identify with that. Verses 9 to 14 says, "And when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, 'Come and have breakfast.' None of the disciples dared ask him, 'Who are you?' They knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came, he took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same thing with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus had appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Now, in the past, the disciples had experienced some wonderful times with Jesus, but now they needed to come closer to him again. After all the stresses and the strains that they had endured, they needed bringing back to the basics of personal fellowship with Jesus. They needed just to be with Jesus. They needed to receive from him. And that's what happened to them over an informal, freshly cooked outdoor breakfast. Jesus simply came to them and says, verse 13, they took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. It's always so important for us to have an encounter with the Lord. But there are particular times when we, and even the greatest leaders of God have experienced this, we need a new encounter with the Lord. It's like maybe we've run dry, we're running on empty. Elijah, for instance, was burnt out and depressed after his powerful showdown with the prophets of Baal. And he needed to sense the presence of God in a new way and to hear the still small voice of God to give him new perspective and future direction. There were times also when the Apostle Paul needed an angel to encourage him. Maybe you feel burnt out or heavily burdened right now. If so, let me tell you that today is a moment when the Lord wants to come near to you. He wants to come close to you. He wants to bring calm to your troubled soul. He wants to replenish you, to revive you. He wants you to know not only is he for you, but he loves you, and he wants you to feel the sweetness and the warmth of his presence. This is the moment to stop worrying about what you did or what you didn't do, but just relax in the presence of God. Be still and know that he is God. Right now, I believe the Holy Spirit wants to come to you in your quietness so that you can find rest for your soul. You can be restored in your experience of the love of Jesus. And finally, we need to be restored in our calling to serve Jesus. Let's read these verses from 15 to 17. When they'd finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Then the third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Now, Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." For the Christian, there is nothing more basic than this question that Jesus asked. Do you really love Jesus? You may love the work of Jesus. You may know about Jesus. But do you really love him with a passion from all your heart? Now, when Peter answered that, yeah, he really loved the Lord, then the Lord told him that his love for Jesus should spill over or translate into him loving people. Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, was calling for Peter and his disciples to be under shepherds. If you love me, feed my sheep or feed my lambs. What does this mean? To show the love of God to people, to nourish them with the word of God, to look after them with practical care and constant prayer. In our online program today, we've had this feature on how John Wesley ensured that every person won to Christ in their ministry came under somebody's direct and immediate supervision, so that, as John Wesley put it, not even the slightest affliction would go unnoticed. His system of what he called classes or societies is very similar to the G12 vision of discipleship, and it was highly effective. In fact, near the end of his life, consider this, Wesley once claimed that he knew all of the 30,000 people in his societies by name and what their spiritual condition was. Today, whatever our jobs or careers or roles in life, every one of us has this twin calling: to be fishermen and women, to win people to Christ, and to be shepherds of the flock of God. Fishermen, shepherds. We know how to fish. We need to know how to look after the sheep. This is a time when we need to see a great spiritual restoration throughout the world and in our nation. It all begins in our hearts when we have our vision restored, when we have our hearts restored by a new experience of the love of Jesus, and when we have our calling restored so that we understand that people have been and will be entrusted to our care. Let's pray. Let's take a moment now just to let this word just sink into our hearts. First of all, I want to address those of you who may have not experienced the love of God up to now, but you want to be a Christian. You want to follow him. And if that is you, would you just simply pray? You can pray it in your own words, but I'm just going to help you with a little guideline. And pray these words after me out loud if you can. Don't be ashamed or afraid. Lord Jesus, I believe in you and I need you. Please forgive me for my sins through the blood that you shed on the cross for me. Come near to me. Let me feel your presence and your love. Save me, Lord. Heal me, use me, and help me always to walk close to you. In your name, amen. Amen. Now, a simple prayer like that, God hears it and he answers prayer. And you need to make contact with a Christian group like John Wesley. Got everybody connected. Please feel free to connect with us, and we would be delighted to help you grow in your faith, and also to, first of all, invite you to one of what we call life classes. And before I go, I want to pray for those of you who have been Christians maybe for many years. Maybe you're very faithful people. You work for God, you love God, you try and read your Bible and pray and be so faithful in the church, bring your family up in the way of the Lord. But things have just got heavy. And it really seems a little bit oppressive. And you need your soul restored. I'm going to pray for you. Pray with me right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're not a hard taskmaster. And we thank you, Lord, you're not a remote God. But you see us as we really are. You sent your son Jesus into this world as the Savior, but also the shepherd, the good shepherd, who leads us beside still waters, who restores our soul, who guards us, who guides us. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, for showing how to fish for people, how to care for people. But also you said, then when I go, the Holy Spirit will come. And Holy Spirit, when you're with us, we cannot feel orphans. And I pray right now, in different nations, in different places, people of different ages and stages. Come, Holy Spirit, now. Let them feel, as I feel your presence in just my home kitchen. Let us feel, let them feel your presence. Forgive us, Lord, for just trying to battle on. Help us to be quiet and know if we can be in your presence and we can know that your love is there, that your word becomes real. It's almost like we can see your face of love and joy and peace smiling on us. Lord, restore our souls. Revive us. Restore us that we could be your agents of restoration in this world that so badly needs to be restored. We ask all this in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down. I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with hiding, no reason to waste. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father. Saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the prize for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't
to the Father again. Thank you for joining us today. If you have any prayer requests, please contact us at hello@kcionline.org. Or for more information about our church, please visit our website at kcionline.org. To stay connected with us, please go to kcionline.org/connect. Or if you would like to find out more about giving, please go to kcionline.org/giving. And to listen to all our services, go to kcionline.org/podcast or simply download the KCI app on the App Store. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel of King's Church International and our senior pastors Wes and Adriana Richards. We welcome you to join us again every Sunday at 5 p.m. UK time. God bless you.